Thanks to CuriosityStream for supporting PBS Digital Studios. Hey, I'm Jabril, and welcome to Crash Course AI. Language is one of the most impressive things humans do. It's how I'm transferring knowledge from my brain to yours right this second. Languages come in many shapes and sizes. They can be spoken or written and are made up of different components like sentences, words, letters, and characters that vary across cultures. For instance, English has 26 letters and Chinese has tens of thousands of characters. So far, a lot of the problems we've been solving with AI and machine learning technologies have involved processing images. But the most common way that most of us interact with computers, though, is through language. We type questions into search engines. We talk to our smartphones to set alarms, and sometimes we even get a little help with our Spanish homework from Google Translate. So today, we're going to explore the field of natural language processing. Natural language processing, or NLP for short, mainly explores two big ideas. First, there's natural language understanding, or how we get meaning out of combinations of letters. These are AI that filter your spam emails, figure out if that Amazon search for Apple was grocery or computer shopping, or instruct your self-driving car how to get to a friend's house. And second, there's natural language generation, or how to generate language from knowledge. These are AI that perform translations, summarize documents, or chat with you. The key to both problems is understanding the meaning of a word, which is tricky because words have no meaning on their own. We assign meaning to symbols. To make things even harder, in many cases, language can be ambiguous, and the meaning of a word depends on the context it's used in. If I tell you to meet me at the bank, without context, I could mean the riverbank or the place where I'm grabbing some cash. If I say, this fridge is great, that's a totally different meaning from, this fridge is great. It lasted a whole week before breaking. So, how do we learn to attach meaning to sounds? How do we know great means something totally different from great? Well, even though there's nothing inherent in the word cat that tells us that it's soft, purrs, and chases mice, when we were kids, someone probably told us that this is a cat, or a gato, mal, billy, or ot. When we're solving a natural language processing problem, whether it's natural language understanding or natural language generation, we have to think about how our AI is going to learn the meaning of words and understand our potential mistakes. Sometimes we can compare words by looking at the letters they share. This works well if a word has morphology. Take the root word swim, for example. We can modify it with rules. So if someone's doing it right now, they're swimming. Or the person doing the action is the swimmer. Drinking, drinker, thinking, thinker, you get the idea. But we can't use morphology for all words. Like how knowing that a van is a vehicle doesn't let us know that a vandal smashed in a window. Many words that are really similar, like cat and car, are completely unrelated. And on the other hand, cat and felidae, the word for the scientific family of cats, mean very similar things and only share one letter. One common way to guess that words have similar meaning is using distributional semantics, or seeing which words appear in the same sentences a lot. This is one of the many cases where NLP relies on insights from the field of linguistics. As the linguist John Firth once said, "You shall know a word by the company it keeps." But to make computers understand distributional semantics, we have to express the concept in math. One simple technique is to use count vectors. A count vector is the number of times a word appears in the same article or sentence as other common words. If two words show up in the same sentence, they probably have pretty similar meanings. So let's say we asked an algorithm to compare three words, car, cat, and felidae, using count vectors to guess which ones have similar meaning. We could download the beginning of the Wikipedia pages for each word to see which other words show up. Here's what we got. And a lot of the top words are the same. The, an, of, in. These are all function words, or stop words, which help define the structure of language and help convey precise meaning. Like how an apple means any apple, but the apple specifies one in particular. But because they change the meaning of other words, they don't have much meaning by themselves. So we'll remove them for now and simplify plurals and conjugations. Let's try it again. Based on this, it looks like cat and felidae mean almost the same thing, because they both show up with lots of the same words in their Wikipedia articles, and neither of them mean the same thing as car. But this is also a really simplified example. One of the problems with count vectors is that we have to store a lot of data. To compare a bunch of words using count vectors like this, we'd need a massive list of every word we've ever seen in the same sentence. And that's unmanageable. So, we'd like to learn a representation for words that captures all the same relationships and similarities as count vectors, but is much more compact. In the unsupervised learning episode, we talked about how to compare images by building representations of those images. We needed a model that could build internal representations and that could generate predictions. We can do the same thing for words. This is called an encoder-decoder model. The encoder tells us what we should think and remember about what we just read, and the decoder uses that thought to decide what we want to say or do. We're going to start with a simple version of this framework. Let's create a little game of fill in the blank to see what basic pieces we need to train an unsupervised learning model. This is a simple task called language modeling. If I have the sentence, "I'm kind of hungry. I think I'd like some chocolate blank." What are the most likely words that can go in that spot? And how might we train a model to encode the sentence and decode a guess for the blank? In this example, I can guess the answer might be cake or milk, but probably not something like potatoes, because I've never heard of chocolate potatoes, so they probably don't exist. Definitely don't exist. That should not be a thing. The group of words that can fill in that blank is an unsupervised cluster that an AI could use. So for this sentence, our encoder might only need to focus on the word chocolate, so the decoder has a cluster of chocolate food words to pull from to fill in that blank. Now, let's try a harder example. Diana, a friend of mine from San Diego who really loves physics, is having a birthday party next week. So, I want to find a present for blank. When I read this sentence, my brain identifies and remembers two things. First, that we're talking about Diana from 27 words ago. And second, that my friend Diana uses the pronoun her. That means we want our encoder to build a representation that captures all these pieces of information from the sentence, so that the decoder can choose the right word for that blank. And if we keep the sentence going, "Diana, a friend of mine from San Diego who really loves physics, is having a birthday party next week, so I want to find a present for her that has to do with blank." Now, I can remember that Diana likes physics from earlier in the sentence, so we'd like our encoder to remember that too, so that the decoder can use that information to guess the answer. So, we can see how the representation the model builds really has to remember key details of what we've said or heard. And there's a limit to how much a model can remember. Professor Ray Mooney has famously said that we'll never fit the whole meaning of a sentence into a single vector. And we still don't know if we can. Professor Mooney may be right, but that doesn't mean we can't make something useful. So far, we've been using words in our models, but computers don't work with words quite like this. So let's step away from our high-level view of language modeling and try to predict the next word in a sentence using a neural network. To do this, our data will be lots of sentences we collect from things like someone speaking or text from books. Then, for each word in every sentence, we'll play a game of fill in the blank. We'll train a model to encode up to that blank and then predict the word that should go there. And since we have the whole sentence, we know the correct answer. First, we need to define the encoder. We need a model that can read in the input, which in this case is a sentence. To do this, we'll use a type of neural network called a recurrent neural network, or RNN for short. RNNs have a loop in them that lets them reuse a single hidden layer, which gets updated as the model reads one word at a time. Slowly, the model builds up an understanding of the whole sentence, including which words came first or last, which words are modifying other words, and a whole bunch of other grammatical properties that are linked to meaning. Now, we can't just directly put words inside a network. But we also don't have features we can easily measure and give the model either. Unlike images, we can't even measure pixel values. So, we're going to ask the model to learn the right representation for a word on its own. This is where unsupervised learning comes in. To do this, we'll start off by assigning each word a random representation. in this case, a random list of numbers called a vector. Next, our encoder will take in each of those representations and combine them into a single shared representation for the whole sentence. At this point, our representation might be gibberish, but in order to train the RNN, we need it to make predictions. For this particular problem, we'll consider a very simple decoder, a single-layer network that takes in the sentence representation vector and then outputs a score for every possible word in our vocabulary. We can then interpret the highest scored word as our model's prediction. Then, we can use backpropagation to train the RNN, like we've done before with neural networks in CrashCourse AI. So, by training the model on which words to predict next, the model learns weights for the encoder RNN and the decoder prediction layer. Plus, the model changes those random representations we gave every word at the beginning. Specifically, if two words mean something similar, the model makes those vectors more similar. Using those vectors to help make a plot, we can actually visualize word representations. For example, earlier we talked about chocolate and physics. So, let's look at some word representations that researchers at Google trained. Near chocolate, we have a lot of foods like coca and candy. By comparison, words with similar representations to physics are Newton and universe. This whole process has used unsupervised learning, and it's given us a basic way to learn some pretty interesting linguistic representations and word clusters. But taking in part of a sentence and predicting the next word is just the tip of the iceberg for NLP. If our model took in English and produced Spanish, we'd have a translation system. Or our model could read questions and produce answers, like Siri or Alexa try to do. Or our model could convert instructions into actions to control a household robot. Hey, John Greenbot. Just kidding. You're your own robot. Nobody controls you. But the representation of words that a model learns for one kind of task might not work for others. Like, for example, if we train John Greenbot by having him read a bunch of cooking recipes, he might learn that roses are made of icing and placed on cakes. But he won't learn that cake roses are different from real roses that have thorns and make a pretty bouquet. Acquiring, encoding, and using written or spoken knowledge to help people is a huge and exciting task, because we use language for many things. Every time you type or talk to a computer, phone, or other gadget, NLP is there. Now that we understand the basics, next week we'll dive in and build a language model together for John Greenbot in our second lab. See you then. Thank you to CuriosityStream for supporting PBS Digital Studios. CuriosityStream is a subscription streaming service that offers documentaries and nonfiction titles from a variety of filmmakers, including CuriosityStream Originals. For example, you can stream Dream the Future, in which host Sigourney Weaver asks the question, what will the future look like, as she examines how new discoveries and research will impact our everyday lives in the year 2050. You can learn more at curiositystream.com/crashcourse, or click the link in the description. CrashCourse AI is produced in association with PBS Digital Studios. If you want to help keep CrashCourse free for everyone forever, you can join our community on Patreon. And if you want to learn more about how human brains process language, you can check out this video from CrashCourse Psychology.